Psalm 16, 1 through 2 says, "Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing." Heavenly Father, let us see that in you is life. And let us come to the realization that you are with us every step of the way, that we have no good thing that is apart from you. So focus our attention today on the graciousness of your name. And Lord, we will thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. Joined us tonight for our Wednesday night Bible study time. We are calling this From Stuck to Forward, and we are looking at the book of Philippians, looking at how a man in Paul's realm where he was in prison could actually look at things and say, "Rejoice in the Lord always." Rejoice in the Lord always, even when you're in that situation? For Paul, the answer is yes. It's an emphatic yes, and Paul continues to say it all the way throughout this letter to a group of people that had sent him somebody to take care of him, to bring him food and bring him
money and be able to take care of him while he was in prison. At those times, people were not taken care of unless people came to them and took care of them. And so for Paul, that was the Philippians. They were loving and had sent Epaphroditus, and we saw in chapter 2 that had happened, that he came back. He was sending him back to come back with a message. And we believe that message for Paul was this whole letter, but we have been looking at chapter 3 in particular, especially last week. We looked at chapter 3, the beginning, in verses 1 and 2. And today we are going to look at verses 3 to the beginning of 4. I know that it seems like we're moving really slow through this, but next week we will look at Paul and some of his biography and look at who he was as a person. Last week we looked at verse 1 and 2, and it says, "Further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord." Again, there is the words, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord. "It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you," the same things. He was writing to them about the gospel. He was writing to them, trying to instill the gospel into their hearts and into their lives. But then he says something. He says, "Watch out," or "beware for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by his Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh, though I myself have reasons for such confidence." Again, we're going to look at the reasons why Paul had confidence or could have confidence in who he was and what he brings to the table. But tonight we're going to look at verse 3 and verse 4. Once again, the devil wants to destroy people's confidence in Christ's sufficient work for them. He would like nothing more than to have people believe in a false gospel. So beware. He says in verse 2, beware. Watch out. Watch out for the people that would add to the gospel or take away the gospel or make you do something in order to receive the free gift that God is trying and wanting to give to you. Watch out for those people. Also, when you add anything to the gospel, you lose the gospel. It's not Jesus plus the good works. It's Christ and Christ alone. Paul starts off in verse 3 saying, "For it is we who are the circumcision." Now this is really a weird conversation for us, and a weird conversation piece for us, because we don't really fully really understand it, as we don't live in the same period as these people. But essentially, there was a group of people that once again believed in order to be loved and accepted by God, one had to be physically circumcised. But in the Old Testament, though, Israel had been promised that there was a circumcision of the heart that was about to occur. In multiple places it says that, but we'll look at Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6. "The Lord your God will circumcise your hearts in the hearts of your descendants, so that you may love him with all your heart and with all your soul and live." Now it's interesting to me that we hear those words elsewhere in the Bible. Jesus, when confronted with what are the most important commandments, Jesus will say, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself." Right here in the book of Deuteronomy, it says that the Lord is going to circumcise something more than just your physical being. God is going to circumcise you. He's going to circumcise your heart. Something is going to happen. Yet the Jews at this time, even the ones that believed in Jesus, even the ones that thought that Jesus could possibly be the Messiah, once again thought that in order to be loved and accepted by God, you had to do something. But God's love is really for everyone. God desires a relationship with everyone. But he doesn't want us to simply stay the same kind of people. In fact, once you come to God, you can't really stay the same. Paul says elsewhere in Galatians 6:15, for both circumcision and uncircumcision mean nothing. What matters instead is a new creation. For Paul, this inward heart circumcision is a work of the Spirit of God, and it's a blessing of the new covenant. Again, for Paul, Christ is not just one or part of the gospel. Christ is the gospel. It is not Christ plus a physical circumcision. It is Christ coming inside of you through the power of the Holy Spirit in working to enable you to do something and be someone who is the new creation. And it becomes the passport into being a part of God's people. Those who trust Christ are the true people of God. And they are the true circumcision. Following this statement on circumcision, Paul provides three distinguishing marks that we're going to look at tonight of being a Christian. Three distinguishing marks for Paul of being a Christian, or rather being the true people of God. The first two statements are something that are positive, are something that we are to do, and the third one is a negative remark. Mark number one, we serve God by His Spirit. God's people live their whole life as an act of service and an act of worship to God. This act of service is not just an experience of corporate worship on Sunday morning, however, my friends. It is a life lived daily, as Philippians 1:27 points out, in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why? Because Christians are gifted the Spirit of God, which again drives us to a whole different way of living in a whole different way of being in the world. Paul will point out in Romans chapter 8, verse 9, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives inside of you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. There's a story in the Gospel of John when Jesus spoke to the woman at the well. He says this while he encounters this woman at the well. He says, true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. So here's some questions for you on this mark, the mark of serving the Lord by His Spirit. Does the Spirit of God dwell in you? Do you worship and do you serve God by the Spirit? On what are you basing your assurance of salvation? Friends, don't base your assurance of salvation on attendance at meetings or your involvement in social work. Instead, rest. Rejoice that the Spirit of God dwells in you and is enabling you to worship and serve God for the praise of His glory. Once again, social work and loving on people and taking care of people is not the bad thing. The question is, are you basing your acceptance from Christ on that thing? Or are you loving people and are you serving people out of the abundance of what God has done in your spirit when He has come inside of you and living inside of you and moving and reigning inside of you, and therefore you go out and you begin to do things that you have not done in the past? Mark number two, we boast in Christ Jesus. Once again, we boast in Christ Jesus. Our glory is in Christ alone. Again, in Galatians 6:13-14, right before the verse that we just pointed out, it says this, not even those who are circumcised keep the law, Yet they want you to be circumcised, that they may boast about circumcision in the flesh. Once again, they are boasting about the circumcision that they are supposed to get in the flesh. May I never boast except. Here's where Paul says except. May I never boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. We don't glory in our earthly status. We don't glory in our achievements. We don't glory in our gifts. We must glory. We must boast only in Christ Jesus. Paul will say to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 31, the one who boasts must boast in the Lord. If you meet someone who claims to be a Christian, but isn't making much of Christ, then you have a reason to be suspicious of their claim. The Christian life is a Christ-exalting life. So some questions for you on this mark of boasting in Christ Jesus. Do you boast in Christ around your friends? Do you boast in Christ around your family? Do you boast in Christ around your neighbors? Do you boast in Christ around your coworkers? Do you glory in Christ Jesus in your service? You see, churches can really be known for a lot of things and known by a lot of things. But friends, let's be a church that first and foremost is known for boasting in Christ Jesus, in boasting in the power of the Holy Spirit that is moving us and directing us and pushing us forward. Mark number 3 highlights what God's people shouldn't do. We put no confidence in the flesh. Everyone has their confidence somewhere. The Christian's confidence should be in Christ. The Christian's confidence shouldn't be in their own effort or in their own goodness. That is why the Christian boasts and rejoices in Christ. But what does it mean to put our confidence in the flesh? Well, Paul views flesh in really three different ways. First, it's simply the way that most of us think about flesh, and it's this that I'm looking at right now. It's the body's physical material. Second, he speaks of the flesh, and what he means is the weak human realm, as opposed to the heavenly realm, the realm that God is there and God is in. Instead of that, he's talking about the weak human realm, the earthly realm. Third, he speaks of human existence on its own, apart from God and opposed to the leading and opposed to the guiding of the Holy Spirit. So on one level, putting one's confidence squarely in the flesh may refer to trusting spiritually in the rite of circumcision. These men were circumcised and it was part of their physical fleshly realm, which literally takes place once again in the flesh. But beyond that, putting confidence in the flesh means placing your confidence in what is merely human, apart from the grace and apart from the Spirit of God. When it comes to being accepted before a holy God, our nationality doesn't matter. Our rituals don't matter. Our education doesn't matter. And our church affiliation does not matter. But friends, we can stand safely, we can stand squarely, and we can stand confidently before God because of the work of Jesus Christ. So here's a few questions for you on this point of putting our confidence not in the flesh. Where is your confidence? What will enable you to stand before God and receive His grace instead of His judgment? And in what are you trusting in? There's only one place to look, according to Paul. And that is in our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Once again, here are the three marks of what it means to be a Christian in these verses. We serve God by His Spirit. We boast in Christ Jesus, not in ourselves. And we put no confidence in the flesh. We move out and we begin to realize that the Lord and Savior is what is supremely important. Next week, we will continue to look at Philippians chapter 3 and consider the testimony and the biography of Paul as he details his former life before meeting the risen Christ. But before we do, and before we get done tonight, I would like to pray for you. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, I pray for the people on the other side of this screen tonight. I pray, Lord, that you will wrap your arms around them, that you will let them know that above and beyond everything else that they have achieved in their life, and above and beyond anything that they hold dear in their life, let them know that the most important thing is that we would boast in Jesus Christ, that we would know above and beyond everything that, Lord, you are our Lord and you are our Savior. And therefore, when people come against us, we understand that there is one that is still walking with us, still guiding us, still directing us, and is still comforting us, still bringing his hands around us to guide and to direct us. Now, Lord, we pray that we would have faith and trust in you, and that we would know above and beyond everything that you are there for us even now. In your name we pray. Amen. On Sunday morning, this last Sunday morning, I invited you to come and to sign some cards, and I would love to give you that opportunity once again. We are going out and we are going to take some goodies to about 540, 550 different people so far. Our whole goal in this is to love our community, is to hold up our community at a time when they need us. I would encourage you, if you come, it's on the west side of our gym, and there are two mailboxes there. There's a mailbox that has the cards in them, and then there's the mailbox to return the cards, and it says return on it. And those are simply, once again, cards that you can write a little scripture verse and say, we are praying for you. We want you to know that you're not by yourself right now, but that God is there for you. Just a little note of encouragement at this time. Also, on Sunday, we ended with a song, and it's really a prayer. It's a prayer that the Lord would come, that he would keep you, that he would go with you, and that for generations, everybody would know and serve the Lord. Tonight, as we end, that is our song, and that is my prayer for you. Once again, I hope to see you on Sunday morning. May God bless you.
To you, Lord, turn his face. children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children.